could spend a moment with some remarkable people and discover what their life sounds like, what would you ask? Welcome to Are We On Air, an audio encounter. I'm Armand Nafei, and each episode will feature one conversation with an inspiring friend of mine who will share with us the soundtrack to their life. Welcome back to another episode of Are We On Air? This week, I'm with my dear friend, the artist, the muse, Ariana Papademetropoulos. Well, this is our second take. We tried to do this interview, I think we both live in Los Angeles, and we tried to do it before, but our schedules and our lifestyles didn't allow it. And so we are here in Marseille, in France, to do this again. How does that feel?
Wild, isn't it?
Yeah, different worlds. Well, we met in Los Angeles because I reached out to you because of your work. We're talking about doing something at the Chateau, and you know, I see you around and your works and being a muse and inspiring fashion labels and people. So I thought you would be a great person. You created this world, this Ariana world, which is so fascinating. And let's talk about music and your life soundtrack. So to begin with, what's your earliest significant musical memory that shaped you as an artist?
Well, I was on an airplane and I was very afraid of airplanes at the time. I was like 10 or 11, and there was really crazy turbulence. So I turned on the classical music that they had in the airplane, and it just happened to be Indiana Jones. The theme song to Indiana Jones. So it went from being terrified to being on an adventure. And all of a sudden I was like very excited about, I don't know, the slight chance of dying because I was on an adventure versus just being terrified. It just changed the mood. It changed the setting. I'm really into that.
How would you describe yourself with three songs?
Three songs. I guess the first one would be Tomita, Claire de Lune, the cover of Claire de Lune. I think that's probably my favorite song of all time.
Why?
I guess I really do love classical music, but the combination of like the synth noises, it really just takes me to another place. And I like the combination of the past, but with the future. And I just really travel in that song. I think it's the most beautiful song. It just takes me to another world.
I think the past and the future combination is, I think, that kind of sums you up in your work. Mm-hmm. You play with that a lot. You basically take from the past and you create this new world for yourself from all these different elements, like from Hollywood, all the Hollywood to Greek goddess, and with some fairy dust.
Exactly. I love Lolita soundtrack, Nelson Riddle. I just feel like whenever things are going wrong, that's a kind of funny thing. It just changes the mood to being from, uh-oh, this is a disaster, to this is like a funny situation.
Bye.
What's my third song? Gosh, I guess it's another soundtrack, but Midnight Cowboy. I love that song so much.
Yeah, I mean, soundtracks, especially when they're original scores, I think are amazing to literally highlight moments in your own life.
Yeah, I guess you can kind of pretend you're in your own movie, and I kind of like creating my own atmosphere, and so I think that's why I like soundtracks so much, because it kind of creates an atmosphere for my life.
I mean, there are masters who basically, it's like a compilation, they compile a compilation like Wes Anderson, and where music goes hand in hand with the visuals. But then, of course, there are like original scores, you know, by amazing composers. Mm. I think that has a whole different power to it than like an original score in comparison to a so-called compilation soundtrack.
For sure, I agree.
Well, we did mention fairy dust and old Hollywood, mm-hmm. and how you merged your life with your work, from your paintings to your photos to your little castle and caves. Where do you draw your inspirations from? And do you have something on repeat when you paint?
When I paint, I mean, I do listen to lots of soundtracks, but I would say Cristo Redentor, that song by Harvey Mandel. It's the most beautiful song, and it kind of puts me in the mood to paint, even when I'm not in the mood. It's like, yeah.
Are you sometimes like, you get up in the morning, you're like, I have to paint today, or is it like, oh, let's go and paint, I have an idea?
More and more, I'm realizing that, like, I love painting. I used to think that it was like I used to think that sometimes I feel like a slave to my paint, like it's like I'm forced to paint, but really it's,
I like that, slave to a paint, to paint. It's like slave to a rhythm, but slave to paint. It's a new thing now.
But I do, I mean, classical music in general puts me in the space to work. I feel like it triggers a part of my brain that puts me in that place. And then also just, I guess it's escapist music, like music to kind of take me out of this world and into another world. Like, I can't really listen to contemporary music when I paint, unless it's like super dreamy or songs with lots of words, because then I realize that time is going by. And I think that's why I like soundtracks as well so much, because then I don't tell that the time is passing. Because if there's words to a song, or if it's like a punk song which lasts for 2 minutes, you know, like, then I notice that. The only time I'll listen to things is when I'm really, really tired, and maybe I'll put some rap music on to, like, keep me going.
Well, one of your funny moments or extravagant moments was your 70s Mercedes SL in a pink fake fur. Why and what? And what was playing?
So Mac DeMarco directed a video for Iggy Pop and asked to cover my car in pink fur. And I was saying, of course you can cover my car in pink fur. But I ended up keeping it for much longer than the shoot. I kept it on for like 2 weeks. And it was kind of a very surreal experience driving in that car, because every time I would drive down the street, people would be cheering for me. Like, it was like being in a dream where everyone's smiling and waving at you. And I kind of made everyone's day driving that car. And it's just an interesting experience to have everyone smile at you in that way. But it did feel very ridiculous. And I feel ridiculous that people think I did that to my own car. But I did not. It was Mac DeMarco's fault. I guess because it was done for Iggy Pop, I'd have to say that Penetration, I'll listen to that song while I was driving in it.
Well, talking about cars and art on them, we just saw this Porsche Boxster yesterday here in Marseille that was covered in some...
It looked like a Van Gogh car or something, or like Cezanne or something. It was quite hideous, wasn't it? But it made you happy.
It made me happy.
And it just so happened to be from Cologne, where you're from.
Yes. I mean, I don't know if I was happy about that. It was a bit embarrassing. But, well, you obviously have beautiful Greek heritage. Mm-hmm. Your dad is Greek. How much of your heritage do you attribute to your work? Like, how much is there an influence of your heritage?
Yeah, I mean, I'm very inspired by Greek mythology, and I think a lot of my work plays into kind of the mythology of Los Angeles. And I kind of like where those two worlds collide in terms of like Greek culture and like Hollywood culture. I really like the concept of like Greek gods. I think like in Los Angeles, we have the equivalent of like movie stars where we're like obsessed with what they do, and we're interested in what they do in kind of the same way that they would gossip about like the Greek gods, but also just like the mythology that we kind of created the history in Los Angeles. It didn't really exist. And I kind of like where fantasy and fiction combine, and I think that that's very like prevalent in the ancient world and in Los Angeles.
Isn't it funny how it went from Greek goddesses to Roman popes to royals, and now we have Hollywood glamour?
Yeah.
Well, without the glamour, I guess, but
there's a little bit though. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I think there isn't, but there's still little hints of it, at least in some places.
Do you have a favorite Greek song?
I love this Sophia Loren song. I think it's called Sagapo.
I love
Tiene Afto. Yeah. You know, it's from the Boy and the Dolphin soundtrack.
Που κρυφά τις καρδιές οδηγεί κι όποιος το νιώσε το νοσταλγεί. Τι είναι αυτό που το λένε αγάπη, τι είναι αυτό, τι είναι αυτό, γέλιο δάκρυλια κάδα βροχή.
I think I told you that story before. I think I was in Beirut last year. I went to this amazing record store and just digging through the bins, and I just found this beautiful Russian edit or cover, not cover, Russian really pressing from that record, like a 7-inch of Sophia. For like, I don't know, $2 or something. I cherish that so much. It's like kind of, you can tell the patina, it's used and touched, and it's from that period, and it's incredible. I love that song. Sophia at her best. Well, talking about Greek goddesses and Italian superstars and glamour, let's talk about Gucci. You're one of Alessandro Michele's muses at Gucci. How did that come about, and how does Gucci sound like to you?
The story is kind of funny. Basically, I was at the flea market and I lost my keys, and I ran into Soko, and Soko was with the creative director of Gucci, but I didn't know at the time. And I had all this fantasy furniture that I bought, and since I lost my keys at the flea market, they had to drive me home. And I think that she just saw me, and I, you know, my studio was in an old mansion and I had all my fantasy furniture. And I think she was just being like, who is this freak? And then next thing I know, they asked me to come to Italy in this beautiful Balthus's castle. And me and my best friend, Zumi. And it was there that I realized that she was the same woman that had given me a ride to my studio. So you really never know when things like that are going to happen. Or, you know, sometimes being a little bit disorganized is okay in the end.
I mean, I think that's what where the connection came from. Like, to see you in your environment, in your bubble.
Right, my little bubble. Yeah. And I think they've... really like a lot of my friends, and I like creating an environment and all my friends and characters that are in it. And now there are a lot of them are involved with Gucci, and it's a very fun thing.
What song would you choose to represent Gucci?
I think maybe Moon Boots by Orlando Riva Sound. I could just see a wild disco party in a castle with lions and flamingos and snakes from chandeliers. Yeah, I think that would be the right song for that.
Talking about luxury, it's kind of shining glamour today, right? Mm-hmm. But for me, luxury is like, it needs to have context, it needs to have quality. That for me is the real luxury. It's not what we were kind of brainwashed to think as luxury. Like, I mean, you look at all the labels that you wear, it's all made in so and so, right? And mm-hmm. and most of the things fall apart after like two seasons, you know. And right. Be it, or let's talk about Apple, same thing, right? Like, or any of the of these brands. So I was watching a documentary on Dieter Rams, you know, the designer of Brown, iconic design. And his approach in the 60s and 70s was like, let's build and design something that lasts, right? Mm-hmm. But then you also saw that he's part of the problem through the Brown products. For example, you are part of the machinery. You create, and people are meant to be consume. But this morning, finally, us being here in Marseille, it kind of came up in my mind. It's like, okay, what's real luxury, right? Mm-hmm. Is it the $1,000 bag with a name on it? Or is it like the local artisan for $200, but it's at a whole different level of, you know, like the art went inside the knowledge, the history,
right.
The experience went into this. And I'm happy to spend that kind of money. I know it's going to last with me forever. And I think that was the kind of approach also Dieter Rams had.
Maybe it's just a combination of both of those things. You can't have one or the other. You kind of need all of it in a way. Because if you just wear like fancy things, it just doesn't... You need a bit of your own take on things. And it's interesting that we're in Marseille, actually, because I do feel like the way that the city plays into nature is really interesting. Like if you look at even like the housing projects... are like, it feels like a, you know, a 1960s collages where you see these giant skyscrapers and they're like in the middle of nature, and it's kind of the combination of new and old. I mean, I think that's like what Le Corbusier's building was here. Like it was supposed to be this little pod in the middle of nature. So I think kind of we just need to keep that balance of new, of old, of... your own taste, of new taste. I don't know. I guess that's like music as well, you know? It's a balance of all the things combined, if that makes any sense.
Yes. To lighten things up again, what have you recently discovered in art, music, or film that inspired you?
You know, I really liked L. Michael's Affair, their new album called Adult Themes. I love that, and I've been painting to that a lot. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Da-da-da-da-da-da.
What's your go-to falling in love or heartbreak song?
I mean, I know it's very obvious, but I do think that The Flamingos, I Only Have Eyes for You, is probably the most, I think it's the perfect song. There's never going to be a better song than that. It's just perfect. And I could fall in love to it, and I could also be happy about being heartbroken to it. There's a Brazilian word for music where it's like the bittersweetness of life. And so it's kind of like you're happy to be sad.
Brazilian Portuguese. Saudade is a deep emotional state of nostalgic or profound melancholic longing for an absent something or someone that one cares for or loves.
Exactly. So that word, I love that there's an actual word for it in Portuguese. That Flamingo song kind of has that element to it where you're kind of happy to be sad.
My love must be a kind of blind love. I can't see anyone but you.
Well, when you're not sad and you're back feeling happy and running around Marseille, feeling sexy, what's the sexiest song?
The sexiest song? I mean, this is kind of funny, but I do think that Billy Idol, Eyes Without a Face, is a very sexy song.
I love that song. Well, to wrap up our little chat, if your life would be a movie, which I think it is, what would play in the end credits?
Well, it might have to be You Only Live Twice by John Barry.
Well, thank you very much for our little chat.
But of course, Armand, it's nice to see you on the other side of the world, in Marseille.
For this episode's playlist, visit areweonair.com, where you'll be able to enjoy the full playlist mentioned in this conversation.